Good evening, everyone. Harvey had asked me to just do a quick introduction, and then we'll talk for a couple of minutes. My name is Tiziana Dearing. I am the relatively new permanent host of Radio Boston on WBUR. We air at 3 o'clock when there's not an impeachment trial going on, 5 days a week, on 90.9 or on the web at radioboston.org. Prior to that, I was in the School of Social Work at Boston College as a faculty member, and I was the first woman to run Catholic Charities for the Archdiocese of Boston, and then an organization called Boston Rising, which focused on breaking generational poverty in Grove Hall. Social justice and the power of storytelling to build empathy, human connection, and transform lives has been core, I feel, to the work I've cared about for a long time. And when I had an opportunity in October to interview Harvey for Radio Boston about Soul Witness, I found in that documentary those kinds of stories. So Harvey, how did this film come to be?
Well, before the film came to be, there was actually a project that they call the Brookline Holocaust Witness Project. So in the 1980s, the town of Brookline formed a committee to decide how that community wanted to recognize the Holocaust. And two people on that committee, they were the chair people for that committee. One of them was Leon Satinstein. And at the age of 27, he had seen the liberation of Dachau. And the other was a woman named Regina Barshak. And Regina was a survivor from France. And at the time, Boston, from what I understand, was making plans for the memorial that's there now. Brookline was deciding what it should do. So Leon and Regina convinced this committee in their town that they should create a living memorial to the Holocaust, and that memorial would be in the form of Holocaust testimonies.
And how did you come across those testimonies, and how did that lead to the film?
Well, I was doing all this work for the Brookline Youth Awards, and I have my own video production business, and ADW Video Productions, if you need anyone. So the director of inclusion and diversity and community relations, Dr. Lloyd Gillenow, for the town of Brookline, contacted me and asked me if I wanted to do a documentary on Brookline. And I was really excited because I was doing all of this work for the community, and now I got a paying gig, you know, for the town of Brookline. You know, I was over there quickly. And in his new office, there was a big metal closet. And I remember not understanding why he was opening up the door to the closet. And he was having a hard time getting it open. And I saw these tapes. They were dirty. And I didn't understand why he was showing them to me. And there were 3/4-inch tapes. They're called U-matic 3/4-inch tapes. They were the broadcast quality back in the late 70s and early 80s. So that's what the access station at Brookline used in the 90s. And so he handed me one, and I had it in my hand, and I remember telling him, if you want me to do a documentary on Brookline, it's going to cost you a lot more money if I have to go through all these tapes. And he said, well, all of these tapes, each one represents a testimony from a Holocaust survivor. And I looked down, and there was a name. I don't remember the name and the crew. And I just remember it was like something just shot through me. It was... I remember having a hard time even responding to him. And one thing I remember is that my hands were dirty because the tapes were dirty. And when I was talking to him, it was like, well, if I have to go through all of these, and And I was upset that my hands were dirty because I thought I was going to catch something. I mean, they've been in that closet for a long time. And it felt like there was fumes coming out, you know. And when he told me that it was a testimony from a Holocaust survivor, and he told me the tapes had been in that closet for over 20 years. And I remember feeling shame a little bit that I didn't want to hold them. And I just sort of knew that my whole trajectory of my life would change. I didn't know how, but I'm here right now, so I guess this is how.
So you did hold them, and you held them in a sustained way and made this film. How many people in the audience have seen it before? Okay, so that's very few. I imagine that those who haven't might be approaching tonight with some trepidation. This is very painful subject matter. What should people expect from what they're about to see?
I understand, you know, being nervous about watching the film. To make the film, I knew I was going to have to spend a long time with them, so I was afraid. It was at least a week, probably a couple of weeks, where time's ticking. I didn't have long to make it, and I wouldn't watch it. Mm-hmm. So I was just afraid. What I've learned from this whole process is the power of listening, not only what the person who's being listened to receives, but also what you receive from listening. And audiences walk out feeling better, I think. I think one thing that the audience will take away from it is that they'll be glad that they spent an hour with these people they're about to see.
And I think my last question for you before we show the film is there anything in particular, guidance for the audience of what you recommend they be thinking about or things they'd be looking for or paying attention to, or the heart or the stance with which they receive the stories while they watch?
Listening is one of the hardest things that you could do. You do it for a living. I do it when I'm doing this work and for my living. And, you know, sometimes I say that listening is the hardest thing to do. That's why no one ever does it. To make the film, I had to pay attention and I had to be present and I had to be a vessel for them, the people that you're about to meet. And so I think just to allow yourself to take in the voices, and we all have our running voice that's always in our head, to sort of put that aside for a time. And I know it's the Holocaust, and the Holocaust is hard, but these people lived through it, and we're just going to be watching a movie for an hour. So.
And then we'll have time to reflect together afterward. All right.
Thank you.
Harvey.
Thank you all for being here.